making your way in the world today. You really need a pod. Why don't you put your headphones in and give this one a shot? Wouldn't you like to just listen away? And go to a place where everybody knows who you are. Listen to Two Guys Brew Haha. Cold Street Brewery and Full Buddy Cast, two of the greatest names. Why don't you go and listen to this episode?
All right, everyone, thanks so much for listening to another episode of Full Buddy Cast Presents Brew Haha. We got,
now we're here.
We got some beers.
We got Sean McDonald from Cole Street Brewery, 1627 Cole Street, Enumclaw, Washington. So you guys, I got to be honest with you. I get into the zone, the auto zone. I get, like, Sean will tell me things, and I'm already focused on the next thing. So he probably mentioned, that guy's voice is not as good as mine. Remember the urban legend about that?
No.
They said that that was Woody Harrelson that sang that.
No,
it kind of sounds like it, but
it does kind of, but then it's got an accent to it.
Yeah, yeah. I heard it. I heard that was the rumor, but I don't think it's real. What was the other rumor? Family tie or no? What was the
Family Ties with Michael J. Fox?
No, yeah, but what was the one he? It was Growing Pains was sung by Alan Thicke. He wrote it and sung it himself, I heard. Yeah. And that's why his son's so talented, too. All right. Anyway, that's your random.
What was the thing that you started with before I started playing?
I don't know. I was just going to say how I get focused and I don't even pay attention. Sometimes Sean will tell me stories. I feel bad. This actually happens quite a bit. Like, I'm in my brain thinking on things. And there we go. He's pouring that. That sounded good. What's this beer? Beer of the week. This smells good.
This is another experimental one. This is going to be coming out closer to June.
Okay.
Possibly July, mid-June, late July. This was a test batch. So this is another one in conjunction with the Urban Sanctuary.
Can I guess this?
Absolutely. Did you see the picture?
No, I didn't.
She made a label.
This is...
conjunction with the Urban Sanctuary. Urban Sanctuary is on Myrtle Street, 1221 Myrtle Street. Urban Sanctuary is a sanctuary where you can just go and hang out, center your zen, go to yoga classes. They have a labyrinth walk.
What is this stuff? What is this spice?
It's very familiar. Like, everybody knows it.
It's crazy. It's like almost as if like I don't know if you've ever been to like
Nature's Inventory.
Yeah, Nature's Inventory.
That's on Cole Street too.
So sort of like that. You walk in, and you can smell. It's like it's a smell that hits you immediately, and you're like, okay, I know that I'm in like a very mineral and natural type area. And this tastes. Hold on. One more sip. Hold on. Give me some ABV and stuff like that. Like.
So this is on the low side. It's a 6%. It is a lager, and so this is another Trappist beer. So we did it in conjunction with them because they do the whole calming thing, just like the monks sitting and praying.
Yeah.
Trappist style. I can't do an actual Trappist beer because
you're not a monk.
I'm not a monk at a monastery.
Yeah.
It's an aged lager. This was also brewed in January, so we're at
six months. You are already in my zone of what my next question is going to be, but I'm loving this. I'm gonna say what it's not. It's not cinnamon. I don't know why cinnamon jumps into my head. It's not cinnamon.
Well, that's the most common spice, so everybody knows.
It's not like a lavender. It's not like a rosemary. It's not like
I think you're overthinking it.
I am way overthinking. I
don't know. She made a nice, pretty label that looks like that. What is that on that label?
On the very bottom, right?
No, on the top.
Well, that looks like lavender.
It is lavender.
Oh, this is lavender?
So I had to stop you. You're like, it's not lavender.
Well, no. Okay, that's what it is then.
It is lavender. Yeah, beautiful lavender. Got that from the local lavender
farm. That is delicious, man. That is good. You did a good job.
I asked them if they wanted to get involved, and they didn't really want to do it. So I think they wanted me to get money out of them. So We're just going to.
What am I doing on this one then for this? Are we shouting them out?
No, we're shouting out Urban Sanctuary because in conjunction with Urban Sanctuary, oh, okay. She was looking for like an herby sort of thing.
I see. And
she's going to do an event in conjunction with this. She hasn't really labeled that event yet. But
did she create that can art or the beer art? That
was all her? This art. Yeah, we're going to take a picture of it and put it on our site. She's made this for labeling the bottles, and so we're doing kind of like a fundraiser sort of thing. When you buy a growler of her beers, you get a bottle that has this beautiful art on it, and then proceeds go to her.
Nice. Wonderful. I like that.
Just to help her out, because like I said in the last episode, her little shop has been shut down for the past 2 months, almost 3 months, because of the road work, and it's super unfortunate. And she doesn't need a lot, but she does need a little hand. So.
Dude, you are hitting it hard with you don't even know what I was going to ask you, and you're already there. Like, you're already there. Okay, so two things. I gave you guys a tease last week. We're going to talk about the Lavendar Lager here in a second, but two things that I had a tease last week, okay? The tease last week was this. I was going to give it as a shout out. I really like how Enum Claw and the businesses of Enum Claw adapted through the unknowns.
Yeah, still adapting.
And still adapting of the COVID pandemic. Like that being shut down, moving people outside, 25% occupancy indoors to outside. Like it was always changing, always moving, but it did seem that and I know that it's, you know, it takes a lot of people and to make and help and come together. It reminded me of Whoville.
It's a community, yeah.
Yeah, reminded me of Whoville. Just like everyone holding hands together.
Have to have it.
You know, we had the Grinch that was trying to shut things down. COVID. I'm not saying who the Grinch is. Like the Grinch who stole Christmas. But Whoville got together, Enum Claw got together, held hands, sang Abu, and then they did what they could do. I looked back at it today. No, sorry. I shouldn't say today. Yesterday. And I was thinking about what do I remember of the past 2 years in downtown Enum Claw? I remember a few different things. The cruise, obviously. Mm-hmm. Things, you know, the streets shut down. I remember the very beginning of this darn thing. It was a ghost town.
Yeah, it was crazy looking up and down the street and nobody's parked on
nobody's
the street.
Nobody's parked. All restaurants are shut down. No one's...
Crazy.
This was even before people were doing just to-go only. Like, it was like 2 weeks of nothing.
And it was quieter than it would be at like midnight or 1 a.m. in downtown, which is crazy.
Just...
Like, that you think that's ghost town time. No, it was crazy. Nobody.
Nothing.
Yeah.
And then life... You know, people got creative to go only and then opened up to where outdoor eating. And then, I mean, there were bubbles. You know, there was Sean. I picture Sean just running every which way to get people food and come back. And yeah, just anything to keep it going and keep Enum Claw too as well.
Yeah.
Still feel that hometown.
Yeah, I mean, prior to the pandemic, I mean, we the first year and second year that we did Sundays on Coal, we had at the beginning and at the end, we had a community dinner where we shut down Coal Street and we put tables right down the middle of the street. And, you know, everybody, the community came together and just had a dinner together. That's Enum Claw right there.
Yes.
And then obviously then COVID happened where we couldn't really do that. But at the same time, we kind of did where everybody was sitting outside kind of together. You know, it's kind of a joke of the whole spacing.
I mean, we adapted and super like I know that who knows? You read the news one moment and it looks like, hey, this is never we're over. New strains, new variants, you know, like who knows? Who knows what the heck's going to happen tomorrow? We have no clue. That's what I'm realizing more and more and more and more and more and more is that every time.
It really hard as business owners to like figure out our future. Like how do we plan anything when there's no way you can't plan.
Right. Right.
That's 2 going on 3 years.
Yeah. So just wanted to say, just like shout out to everyone that was a part of that. Customers that would still come down. Customers that probably could have stayed at home and saved a little bit of money and cooked at home and drank at home. And bought, you know, but they went out. They kept supporting. They kept doing what they, you know. And here's the other thing. I was one of the people that worked from home. Man, I wanted to get out of my house so bad. Like, it was like, so it was nice just to be able to come downtown and be able to do those things. So, shout out to everyone that was doing that. So, I know that you shouted out the,
it was a little bit of a tearjerker that he was teasing.
A little bit. Yeah. But I mean,
he's getting all soft.
I didn't want to, but here's, I wanted to be careful because I didn't want to say like, oh man, I wish we could go back to those days. But
there's a lot of bad things, but a lot of good things.
Exactly. Yeah. There were a lot of, and here's the
biggest thing is the kind of the rules weren't, there was a lot of things that weren't so enforced because it was like, well, you're just doing whatever you can. But that also makes you where, especially our state, they need to refocus on some of these rules are so like,
right.
Why do we have them? Like our community survived perfectly fine without any of those rules that you're trying to really button down now. Like why? What difference does it make? It's really not that big a deal.
Exactly. And it was a complicated time, but yet if you walked into the Ian Claw, it was simple as well. And I'm not saying it was easy. It was not saying that Sean going from this restaurant to that restaurant and you know, it wasn't easy. It was but it made it feel down home, community. Felt like everyone was in this thing together and they were helping each other out as the best of their own ability that they could do it. And then, you know, with everything, you know, you're going to have other stuff pop up because of it, problems that you didn't realize that were there because you'd never tried this thing before. And so now you can't, well, we can't do this anymore, but we're going to try this now. And it was always, you know, always moving, but at the same time, it was just really cool to see. So I don't want to go back to those days. I don't want to be like, oh, wasn't that the greatest?
But there were a lot of good things.
But there was a lot of good things.
Shutting down the street every weekend. And then it also brought all the business owners together. You know, we always knew each other, knew of each other. But during COVID, we literally had meetings like every 3 days because the rules were changing every 3 days.
Yeah.
And we get together and like, what are we going to do? How are we going to bend and change? And still to this day, we meet every other week, which is great, you know, and we have a lot of new businesses coming on that are just entering into it, but they're entering into a family that's already knows a lot about everybody's rules. You know, I'm very focused on alcohol rules. I know all my alcohol rules, but I don't know a lot of the other rules that these other people have to, you know, enforce. And it's great having a community get together like that. And
Yeah. And it's good to see that there's community people that are still pouring into the community and that it seems like that there's new people that are like taking their opening shops in town that are from the community. That's always nice to see too. You know, that it's people are here for a reason. You know, Enumclaw is Enumclaw for a reason and we can't let that change. Like we really can't. We can adapt with the times. I get that. But to keep it with as people move in here, to give them that taste of community restaurants, community breweries, community shops, being you know, being a service to them to help their lives be a little, you know, fun, you know. So anyway, good job everyone. Give yourself a pat on the back.
Okay, anyway, back to beer.
Back to
and,
beer
and ha ha.
Okay, let's go.
What's your joke?
Don't have a joke, but I did want to. I do have beer questions.
Where's the ha ha? Come on.
I'll do some ha ha's here.
Okay.
When we went to Edison City Ale House, I was really surprised by how many different alcoholic beverages there were that had cans, you know, that had can art. I bought a few can art. Like there's a junior IPA. It looks like Ken Griffey Jr.
Quite a few people have asked me about that. They're like, where do I get that? Like,
Edison City Ale House. There's other ones that were just cool looking. They had roller derby girls. They had you know, outdoor stuff. It's just very artsy and cool can art. And you could tell it was also some of these things were from the Pacific Northwest just based upon kind of the earthy tones that they used for the for the can art, right? So it was funny. I was going to ask you about can art. Hmm. It, I know that you don't.
Well, I have an opinion, but it's from Beer Geek side of things.
Yes. Okay. I'd like to hear your opinion on that and being
beer,
a beer geek.
So beer geek thing. A lot of times, you walk into a brewery. If you walk in and it looks like a garage, it looks like kind of, you know, there's not been a lot of upgrades to the building.
Yeah.
You're going to find good beer, right?
Oh, okay.
If you walk in and all you see is t-shirts and you see, you know, all this other memorabilia type stuff like everywhere, and you're like, eh, is the beer going to be all right? But that being said, I'm kind of calling myself out because if you walk in my shop, I have a bunch of swag right in the front and that sort of thing. I have quite a bit of swag. The second question is like, how long have you been in business? Mm-hmm. So I've been in business long enough to establish my beer where I have great beer that comes in. My regular standard beers are great. And then I have a good seasonal flow of decent seasonal flow. I've been in business long enough to establish the beer first and then grow to the swag. Mm-hmm. Versus a lot of other breweries, they're all about the flash and the pretty thing. And that's always what I joke about on can art too, because I know an awful lot of people, they don't even look what style of beer it is. They see that can and that's what I'm going to get.
Yeah. Right? Yes. And that's kind of where I was. I mean, I bought a few based off of that.
That's been around forever. If you go into the wine aisle, it's the same thing. Mm. When you're looking at a wine shelf, a lot of times you're not looking at the price. You're not looking at what. You're kind of in the reds, you know, it's a red wine, but then you see this label art and you're like, oh my gosh, that's what I got to have. So there's a lot of things that go into that. Sometimes that's just a lot of money spent in like a marketing firm that has figured out what's eye-catching, mm-hmm. that sort of thing. So it's not even, but some of the art, that's why you got to kind of pay attention to the art if it looks like it's a hand art, because that's some artist that's also getting paid to put art on there.
Right.
We have a great local artist that, I have to think of the brewery that he goes,
we'll maybe on a future episode, we'll talk about it, but
he does, yeah. There's a local brewery that he does all the can art for them. And it's great because he's putting his own spin on stuff, yeah. out there, and it's, you know, and it's great that a brewery is looking to local people to provide that can art, but. That being said, you know, a lot of times it's just computer generated sort of thing. Then,
yeah.
So for me, I'm not a can art person.
Yeah.
It can be cool, but it's not going to make
it. It's not the thing that's going to drive you. You're going to be reading the label. You're going to be reading what's the ingredients or what type of beer and the ABV and all that stuff.
The brewery mainly.
Oh, really? So you are you?
I have trust in breweries. And it's not saying that I won't buy from another brewery, but I put them on different levels. Like, yeah. This is one that 100% I'm going to get that every time. This one, I'm going to be a little leery. Depends on if I'm feeling experimental, okay. or if I'm feeling like, yeah, I'm looking for just something to drink right now that I'm not worried about not being able to drink the whole thing.
Now, without naming names, because we're always here about spreading love, but you do your bottle share, and you've done your bottle share mm-hmm. for years.
Yeah.
Has there been a brewery, again, don't name names, that has been like, wow, this was a really great beer.
Oh, yeah.
And then, wow.
This is
a really flip the switch, not yeah. that good of a beer. I'm surprised kind of yeah. thing.
Yeah, there have been a couple. And what happens there is I feel like they get outside their comfort zone. So they have certain beers that they do really good, and then they experiment on something, which I do the same thing. That's why I start with small batches of my experimentals. Yeah. That way it's like spaghetti on the wall. Maybe it's going to stick. Maybe it's not. And you kind of, but that being said, bigger companies don't have that option. They don't really have a smaller size to mm-hmm. do. So once they do it, it's kind of committed. But in my opinion, you should know before you totally commit to it.
Right. But. Right. Have you, with the lavender lager that we're drinking right now, have you brewed lavender before?
I have not. So I've kind of steered away from it because I always, you know, this is my beer geek side coming out. Even on the first smell of it, I think of soap right away. and soap, I make a liquid. I mean, I was in a winery and I have a brewery. And soap is like the devil when it comes to liquid, because soap gets into liquid and it is so hard to get out of it.
Oh, really?
So if you use some type of vessel to dump your fruit in or something like that, and you wash that vessel with soap and then you didn't rinse it good enough and then you dumped it in. This fruit was in there for 2 seconds. It barely touched that. And then you put it in there and it could ruin a 1,000-gallon batch of liquid. Mm-hmm. And you there, no matter what you do, you can dilute it. You can put more liquid in there. It's still there. That soap is just so frustrating. So my first thought in my brain, when I smell lavender, I just straight think soap. Yeah. And I'm like, ugh, I don't want that in my beer. I don't want soap in my beer.
Right.
Because I can't get rid of it once it's in there.
Yeah, it's got a sweet taste to it, a little bit. A little sweet taste to it. You can tell the hint of lavender for sure. But I don't, like, it doesn't taste like soap to me, because I feel like soap's got that, like, that what, I don't know what type of taste that is, but it's like, you know, when you get your, I don't know, you guys remember that when you guys, I did. I had a bar of soap in my mouth like a kid, you know, like.
I'm not surprised with your mouth.
so you know, it didn't have that soapy soap taste. You know?
The other thing that I did with this is lavender is very young this time of year.
Okay,
it's just starting to flower. It's not actually flowering right out. And most of the fragrance comes from flower, and that's where, from the flowers, and that's where I use some dry in like a dry hop stage. But I took the very young, and so if you know anything about growing anything like a seed, it has a bunch of sugar built up, and then it pops out and it spreads that sugar out to its veins. It's pushing sugar out and it's growing really fast. So it's really sugary and really sweet. So I grabbed those. Sorry, I murdered a bunch of baby lavender, but there's plenty more. But so that's also why this is much sweeter than, you know, but I did have to come back through with the, so you don't get as much nose from that. So then you have to, then I use some dry lavender that's, you know.
Yeah.
Got the very aromatic,
keeps it that, gives it that lavender scent. Yeah. Now you had said that the beer has been, you created this back in January, and so it's been fermenting. How long, again, we may have covered all this stuff in the past, but it's good to cover stuff. You know, you get a wine sometimes and it's like, this was from 2002 or this was from 19, whatever. Like, what's the diff? Like, do you want beer to be that old?
So that's a really, really long and deep conversation.
I love.
We can go for hours on this.
Okay.
So let's start with wine, because I can just do a real brief overview of it. So with wine, they take the grapes, they're smashing the grapes, and they're fermenting the grapes. They ferment grapes in stainless steel containers just like I do. But then after it's fermented, they have the alcohol, then they're taking it and transferring it to barrels, right? Okay. And each barrel is different. There's charred barrel, different levels of char. There's different types of wood. Each one of those does a completely different thing, right? And that's where your years come in. So, and there's different reasons to put it in the barrels. So with white wines, you don't need to age it as long. Because you're not looking for as many tannins. Tannins, I always talk about tannins as kind of, I just think of it as like a wool blanket. It's a bunch of fibers, right? And so you don't want a bunch of fibers in a white wine. But in a red wine, you want those fibers, because otherwise it's way too sweet. It kind of just like blankets your tongue versus like just hits your mouth and explodes in your mouth. You couldn't handle how sweet or how tart or whatever those flavors would be, just way too strong. Versus you have this blanket that's kind of slowing it down. It's almost like a net slowing it down. But that being said, you don't want too much of that too, because right. then you got the flip side where it's really, really bitter. It's really, really, you know, so that's the aging process of the wine. And that's why there's different years. And again, it really depends. That's why this is such an endless conversation, because there's white wines, red wines, there's different levels of red wines. There's different, you know, that's endless. On beer, same thing, except we're only split into arguably only two groups, lager and ale. So an ale is top fermenting. It's a warm fermenting. That means it likes to be warm, and it goes really, when it's warm, like everything, everybody moves kind of faster when we're warm, right? When we're cold, we act slower. So ales, you put it in a fermenter, you ferment it for 2 weeks, and then you can literally put it right on top right then. Done with it. With lagers, they like to be fermented cold. colder things move slower. Mm. So that's why it takes much longer to get things done with a lager. But also, on the flip side, an ale gets done faster, goes bad faster, right? Because it needs to stay warm, and you can't take a burger and put it out in the sun. It's great right out the grill in the sun, right? But if you leave it in the sun, it's gonna get bad.
Cool down, right? Yeah.
So it's kind of the same thing. So it'll go bad faster versus a lager. As long as you keep it cold, it won't go bad. Mm-hmm. And different lagers take different amounts of time because they're moving so slow and it takes so much longer for them to actually do something. That's why a lot of lagers take, 6 months. I think the shortest one is probably 3 months, but on average, it's like a 5 or 6 month fermentation. Like, you got to sit there and just wait for it to get done. Versus ales, 2 weeks, in, out, done. That's why it's much easier to do, anytime I do stuff with other companies and stuff, hey, we can get together and collaborate on an ale because it's much easier. That way, if it doesn't work out, we can just dump it, do it again. But a lager, you're really committed, long-term, committed to it.
So then, when does it go bad? When does it go bad?
A lager?
Yeah.
A lager really doesn't go bad. It just slowly loses flavor. So then, versus an ale, when it goes south, it loses flavor at first, but it's really quick, loses flavor, and then it goes sour. It's a lot of people, bad breweries will take it and turn it into quote unquote a sour, when really it's quote unquote, or in reality, it's a vinegar. It's getting more and more vinegary, bad vinegar flavor.
Okay, because I remember back in the day when it was so cool, it was a gimmicky, thing, born on date, And so, is the born on date better to drink it faster, sooner, or is it better to let it sit for a couple months? Or
so that's another kind of a deep conversation because of who you're talking about that put born on dates on there,
right?
So with a lot of the big chain companies, they'll brew a beer like a lager, and they take it, but then they warehouse it. It's kind of expensive to warehouse it in a refrigeration unit, right? Because you got to maintain that fridge. You got to, that's power use versus just a storehouse that's just, you just have the space. You don't have the space plus the cooling units, right? So a lot of stuff gets fermented cold, kegged cold, and then put into a warehouse warm. That's not good for, we just talked about with the nail. When it gets warm and it stays warm, then it goes bad. A lager loves to stay cold. As long as you keep it cold, it can last quite a while, way past any of those born on. And the born on date is when it was born. Does it tell you when it dies? It's not really saying that.
Right. That's what I'm saying.
There's no real actual death date to a lager.
Okay.
There is a fall off date, but that fall off date can be it can vary. It depends on what it is. So we're talking light lagers. Light lager, there's really not a whole lot of flavor to fall out. So the biggest thing is the longer it is, the flavor slowly starts falling out of solution. So it goes to the bottom of the glass. So the top of the glass is going to be kind of more and more nothing, nothing, nothing. But a light lager, what is there? It's already a nothing.
Yeah.
So is there? So you can take a can of Bud Light from the 1970s, and as long as it was refrigerated, you crack it open right now, is it going to taste any different? Provided, outside elements, the can is still clean and it's been refrigerated the whole time, it's going to taste the same.
Well, I got a funny question, because I don't know if anyone else does this. This is who I am. Okay, I'm hosting a barbecue, or I'm hosting a Christmas, people coming over. I got my cooler on my back porch. I'm not talking a cooler that's plugged in. I'm talking one that you throw, ice in.
Yeah.
Right? So then I buy my bottles of beer, because I can toss it out with everybody. But then it sits in there. There's three or four or five, stragglers that don't all get drank. So
do
then
they stay cold, or do the ice go away? And
so the ice goes away, right? And then I'll have it sit in that cooler for the next 5 months. And so, and every once in a while, I'll get a wild hair, and I'll throw some ice in there. Oh, I'll drink these today. So every night or every day, they warm up in this plastic cooler, and then they cool down in this plastic cooler, and then they warm up.
Not good for them. And really, all you're kind of doing there is you're, that's where the whole skunk beer kind of comes from, like the green bottle beer or the clear glass beer. It's kind of the same thing. All that's basically happening is there's a little action going on in there that's going to create more of a skunk. So those are still drinkable, but when you crack it, it's probably going to foam quite a bit. Right off the bat, it's going to foam. And then that foam is going to kind of stink. And when you drink it, it's going to be a little more on the skunk side. Not bad, not vinegar side, but kind of more, you know, I don't know, that tangy kind of.
Yes.
A little different. Yeah.
And then, and I wonder still why. Drinkable. And I wonder why I have flakes in my beer bottles. Because well, is that what we would do? Would you see start to grow and then die and then grow and then die?
Basically, yeah. There's a little action going on in that can. And that's temperature change. Like I said, as long as you stay consistent with something, I mean, or with the lager, as long as you stay a consistent temperature, it'll last forever.
Gotcha. Okay. Well, see, I'm glad I learned that. Now,
that's also a good test. In my mind, I'm playing with the idea. Maybe I should purchase a fridge, and I should put some beers away right now of all the major big companies, and in 20 years from now,
yeah,
then crack them and like, all right, let's do a comparison.
Yeah.
And see, in theory, that should be provided, you know, there's no, you know, defect in the can or something wrong.
And it's never going to eat through anything.
But the other question is, and this is what I just brought up a minute ago, is how those big companies treat their beer. Because mm-hmm. So that could affect it. Where did I purchase it from? Was it sitting at a you know, a 7-Eleven where it was in the back room?
Yeah.
And then got put in the fridge? So it warmed up on a truck, warmed up in a back room, then got cold. Then yeah. I got it. There's all those different steps that I don't know. Versus going to a small town brewery or a smaller brewery, you know where that's been, and you know,
get a crowler.
How many people have touched it and how long it's sat there, or you have a very good, you know, guesstimation.
So what about then the kegs? When you, because you pour your beers in a sense out of kegs, right? They're all in kegs.
Correct.
So when you tap, we've all been there. We've had a birthday party, you know, whatever, wedding, where we tap a keg and then we're just pushing that keg all night long and pouring and pushing that keg all night long. And then, like, let's say we still have that keg left over. It's like 3 days, 4 days. And
I'm just going to point out the motions that you're making, motions that you're making.
Yes.
You're pumping. What are you pumping? You're pumping oxygen into a keg.
Okay.
That's not good, because that puts oxygen on that beer, and then that beer starts deteriorating as soon as oxygen touches it. As soon as you pour it in a glass, it's slowly deteriorating.
Yeah.
You can't pour a glass and set it on your counter and come back a week later and expect it. No, not going to happen.
Okay.
It's going to be bad, right?
Yeah.
So your oxygen is probably one of the worst things, because it carries so many different little bacteria and different things that mm-hmm. are just totally do it. Now, if you're pushing CO2, which is a, you know, more of a purified air, it's more just pressure. And so what it does is it's heavier than oxygen. So it'll go into a keg. It'll sit right on the beer. If there is any oxygen in there, it'll be above it, not touching the beer.
Okay. So it kind of keeps it pure.
So that's where in like my fridge, when I put beer on tap, I'm pushing CO2 into it that's sitting on there. So even if there was oxygen, it could still sit in that keg. And even if I pulled that keg off and I set it in the back corner of my cooler and I came back to it like 3-4 months later,
yeah,
it's going to be the same beer, because it hasn't changed. Temperature is still consistent and there's no oxygen touching it. So kind of just the motion that you're saying about doing the whole back party sort of thing. Yeah. As soon as you put oxygen, you're going to have to finish that whole entire thing. It's just like a glass of beer. You just,
and even wine. I've seen people pop the cork and then it's like, you only have so much time to really finish off that wine.
Yep.
As well. Oxygen. How do you, when you're brewing, how do you keep the oxygen out?
So what we do is, so we're brewing, so we're heating it up. And so that's boiling, oxygen can't settle on it. And then we're pumping it in to a fermenter while it's super hot and then cooling it down. So oxygen can't sit on there. And then when we push it in, we fill it as full as we can with the hot wort. Fill it as much as we can. Then we cool that down, right? And we try and get rid of all the oxygen in there by pushing CO2 into that tank.
Hmm.
So even as a home brewer, you essentially do the same exact thing. Your biggest thing is not to get oxygen on there. when we drop yeast in, yeast activates and starts eating the sugar, and it pushes out CO2, which then goes up, and it's heavier than oxygen, so it sits right on top of the beer. So as long as you're fermenting, or you are at a hot state where oxygen isn't, can't, you're boiling off any of those bad elements right. from oxygen.
Guys, we got beer nerdy today. I needed it. I needed it. You know, you get these deep dives, and I hope you guys learned something. In fact, we're going to jump into shout-outs right now, but the one thing that that jumped out at me, when I want to shout-out Apple Podcasts, and the reason I want to shout-out Apple Podcasts is because when we went to Edison City Ale House, you know, we have mutual friends. We're Pacific Northwest, and so is, you know, even though it was, you know, about 45 minutes away from where we're at, you know, we just assume someone on Facebook shared it or saw it. And Sasha Lynn, who's a Patreon, she's one of the owners of Edison City Ale House. She just kind of popped up on both of our, you know, posts. She became friends with us. She was social liking media, our stuff. Social media.
Yeah.
And that was like, oh, she must know somebody. So we asked her, hey, so how did, you know, who recommended BrewHaha? Who recommended, you know, for you to listen to this? And she said, she was just searching because they purchased Edison City Ale House, you know, a few months ago, and she was just wanting to, she typed in brew.
She just wanted more information. She was looking for some type of informational.
Yeah, something to learn. Because
we spread so much information.
We're so smart, gosh darn it. So shout out to us as well. But the but she said, and then she listened to the BrewHaha, and she was learning something, right? And that was like, that's cool. You know, yeah, we bring, you know, we like to bring local events. We like to talk, but she got to learn a little bit, you know, she got to learn something. And then she said this, she goes, and then the Garage Night guys, which is great friends with Sean as well, Craig and Corey. you know, she's like, and that's like all of our inner boys, you know, so those are Friday. That's my shout out, or that's my, Friday morning's cross promotion. But the funny thing is so shout out to Apple Podcasts that she searched it and it was there. And available to her. And then shout out to Sasha for continuing on. and also shout out to you for bringing to Sean for bringing that beer nerd, beer geek type thing that we need for this podcast. Absolutely.
I've said it a million times. I don't know what I know until you ask.
Exactly.
If you ask, then I can spit it out. I don't.
Yes.
Most of the time I know most things.
Yeah, and if he doesn't,
I'm not going to say I know everything.
Yeah, we can hit it up later and get back to you on it. But
there's always the Google.
Please hit us up with questions. We love the questions. No question is a dumb question. I mean, unless it's coming from me, then it's kind of a dumb question. Well, but
it's
for
supposed to be a funny question. I don't ever hear very much ha ha. No.
Listen, I barely a ha ha. But real quick, just again, want to shout out the Patreons: Kellen Hall, Holly Graff, Eric Madrid, Adam Kenny Art, Seth Loop, Cassie Spencer, Amanda Keating, Shekinah Sarver, Jared Skelly, Homer Robertson, Veronica Lara, Ben Illman, Jamie Roberts, Jamie Kenny, Apollo Dolo, Jackson Zydek, Sasha Carey, Sasha Lynn as well, Russell Brannon, and I want to shout out everyone's posting these freaking hoodie pictures. I don't want to shout out the weather either. I hate the weather. Weather is sucking. I hate the weather. Everyone's wearing their hoodies though, which is a good thing. Bad thing. This sucks. Give me some sun. I'm tired of this. There you go. I ranted there.
Ah, nice rant.
Shout out.
My shout out is to Luke Shasma. Yeah, he and I went to high school together, and then he reached out recently because his wife was turning the big 4-0.
Nice.
Lindsay Streeter Shasma.
Went to high school with her. She was on my grade, yep.
So then, had a bunch of Streeters, bunch of Van Hoofs, Ainsworths. I mean,
so you had the town of Enumclaw.
All those names are all related in one way or another, and it all comes back around, and they're all hanging out at the brewery. So great time. It's a lot of very familiar faces that haven't seen in a long time.
Yeah.
So shout out to Lucas, you know, obviously, you know, keeping it local and saying, hey, you know, he has a local trucking business, SRS Trucking, I think it is. And he trucks and hauls stuff. I don't really know how to promote him, but he seems to be doing great with his own business, so I don't have to. But I just appreciate that he, you know, sought me out and used my space. That was at my my brewery location. We do events down there currently because we're understaffed. We can't be open like all the time like right. we used to. So if you have a birthday party, retirement party, you know, anything like that, just get in touch and you can come down there. Basically, our rent is you just have to come in and buy beer. That's the rent.
Get in there.
Yeah. Get in and use it.
So that's awesome. Yeah, they're a great family. They live down the street here, and I coached their kid in basketball, and then they moved to him, which I don't blame, because he's a superstar, superstar basketball player. You don't want me messing him up. So anyway, that's awesome. That's cool. So hit you up for anything as things start to open up. You're probably going to want to do some wedding, you know, receptions and stuff like that. Can people bring food into that area? Are you cool?
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. So I obviously have a couple food truck connections, that sort of thing, if you set it up ahead of time so we can kind of coordinate timing-wise. But other than that, I mean, you can bring in – they brought in their own food. They brought in a whole bunch of their own cake and cupcakes, and they had a whole sandwich display and that sort of thing. Bring in anything you want, including get your own food truck or just order pizza. I mean, Frankie's knows exactly where we are. So
nice. Right on. Well, cool. So plan your next event there. Thank you so much for listening. Have a great week. Enjoy your lives.
Yeah. Cheers.
Making your way in the world today, you really need a pod. Why don't you put your headphones in and give this one a shot? Wouldn't you like to just listen away and go to a place where everybody knows who you are? Listen to two guys brew ha ha. Cold Street Brewery and Full Buddy Cast, two of the greatest names. Why don't you go and listen to this episode?